that is really interesting.
So yeah, we'd just like to open for now for discussion. If you guys have questions, shoot. Hopefully you can move forward.
Thank you for that. Thank you. What I might add to what you were saying, Elisabeth, is when I was doing my master's, I was teaching introductory biology, which included, so I think the entire number of students for that course was about 600. And in an introductory biology course, there were a number of dissection labs, and including rat dissection. Which I found ridiculous, particularly at that level, where many students would certainly not be going on into anything that dealt with direct animal care. So I was opposed to dissection as a laboratory instructor, and so rather than just merely dissenting and not teaching those courses, I essentially demanded that I be able to teach an alternative to dissection for the students who I knew were out there who wanted the material. Because at the time, we were told not to, and this is what, there was no transparency, we were told not to offer an alternative to the dissections in any way. If a student approached you, that's fine, they didn't have to do the lab, but the alternative assignment was punitive. It was a much more onerous assignment than those students who had to do the go through the, with the dissection, which I entirely objected to. And I told my students certainly that they did not have to do the labs. I wasn't going to teach them, but I was. And so I fought with the chair of the bio department to be able to teach these labs because I objected to the punitive nature of the assignment. In any case, he finally relented, and it was very well attended, and I mean, back in the day, there weren't as many alternatives, but I employed as many as I could. So it was very well attended. The compromise was that the students still had to go through with the lab practical, so they didn't have to dissect, but they had to move through various stations, identifying parts of the bodies, whatever. And I should say, I'm very proud that my students in that alternative did better, not just on average, but did better than the students who actually went through the actual dissection. But so I would add that there, aside from the students, which you do need to advocate for yourselves, I think there has to be a sanctioned alternative to these labs, that it can't just be this constant sort of fight, you know, for an alternative to, like, case by case, but it has to be offered. And you know, it became popular that the chair eventually asked me to continue with that lab, which I, you know, found a real achievement, and I was very proud of. And so I think that has to happen. That it can't be this, you know, secretive thing that we have to fight for constantly with every class, but part of the curriculum, and eventually, hopefully, it would actually replace the labs. But certainly, it needs to be in parallel with a lot of these courses.
Thank you for adding that, that's really important. And then, I mean, you spoke to the increased pedagogical merit of the alternative. And on the Indonesia website, there are like so many references supporting that your learning is actually just enhanced. For some of the things that I mentioned, you get to do repeats, you get to do like a ton of stuff, you can more openly ask questions probably because you're not feeling,
and even from that kind of pedagogical perspective, I mean, with the alternatives, you know, with students who learn in so many different ways, if you have these options before you learning about an animal system, you're going to be more engaged and you're going to hit different targets that, you know, just having a dead animal before you isn't going to do.
And I think there was one thing that I read recently about, okay, so you're in biology because you're fascinated. So why on earth would you say you're dead? So, yeah. And I know in my own undergraduate training with some dissections that I feel did absolutely nothing for my education. Mm-hmm. Nothing. And, yeah. I think I would have learned more. I think I learned more from
I'm not an analyst, perhaps. I'm a recently retired UC basketball athlete. I get deep. And I certainly saw a lot of people doing their animal research. They did it according to readily about signing no matter what. They did most of the vast majority don't even want to think about what they're acting with animals. They want to think about how I'm gonna answer this question, most expeditiously, and the highest like paper base out of it. That's pretty much how it works. That's the kind of in the 3 3 R's, there's a lot of resistance in these departments that I was associated with. 2 3 R's is actually sort of animosity towards the animal care community here as a result of science feeling they're forcing you to justify the use of animals and you don't want to justify it. It's very, very, that's not true of everyone. It's very, very common. So the answer is I don't think there's a whole lot of that going on.
I think
the
underlying principle just in theory that the CCC reports for the assignment of the attribute recipients is based on the proportionality principle. So if there's the potential for that level of to happen, then you categorize it that way. We've lost years 2000 to 2004 in this chart, but around in the years in between, you can see a spike in the attribute TV. This is one of those examples why there might be spikes in numbers. So it shoots up to here to 770,000. Around that time, there was a really big increase in the creation of new genetically modified animals. And CCC requires that when you create a new genetically edited animal, because of the unknown welfare concerns that might happen, because of knock-on effects and genes that are just unanticipated, you have to categorize those categories, regardless of what the actual animal experiences. And then what happens is once that genetically engineered animal line is stable and you're maintaining it, then you're meant to recategorize it. But for newly created animals, they have to go to category D. And so those are spiked in category D animals. And it's just sometimes the numbers are infinitely complicated to know what they actually mean. Yeah. And that's why I struggle with something like the category of invasiveness, because it's all about the procedure and not about the animal's experience.
And just to make clear what happens with the level of projects being approved by the ACC, the ACC asks the researcher or teacher to indicate what category of invasiveness they're engaging in their project. And then the ACC
well, if you're saying that we
wondering, what does the university have to answer to if they, like, who can go to and say they're not complying with what you ordered?
I can go to the media.
Yeah.
I mean, if you, you know, if you want to get attention,
yes.
You know, it's such a not publicized issue, you know, you can either organize people, I guess, to get a bunch of people to, I don't know, write letters or make themselves heard somehow or ask the media to do it. I mean, I would say that to any political, about any political problem is not getting attention. I don't know specifically about the best strategy for that.
Yeah, I really liked your part about the alternatives and some of those items. And obviously the case for the alternatives is pretty strong in terms of the moral argument, but as you're all probably aware, current systems of valuation don't really tend to take those kinds of things into account. So I'm wondering if there have been any efforts that you're aware of or your own in terms of measuring, say, the economic benefits of going with the alternatives that you mentioned. Say dissection, or which is like, and that's like the main bottom line. But even at an active institution, as was mentioned before, the potential for higher grades was also there. So the second bottom line.
There was a video I watched this morning that's out by Peter, so I can quote that. One is freely available online, where if there were 24 students and 12 for all the section, that would be roughly like $100 for the university. If you buy something that's repeatable, it's like a computer model, but it pays for itself within a year. And it's just, you can just use it infinitely in the future until there are like upgrades or whatever. So if that's the kind of dollar that you're looking for, that's just on the computer website. But I would think that's a really good rationale. Like some of the alternatives that are really sophisticated, like the surgery mannequins, they would be a really big capital output. And there's some very sophisticated things where you can wire up human actors. If you're a med student, you can wire up human actors with various almost like film prosthetics. And that human patient will actually, because they're acting, they would act as if they're like in pain and there's trauma, and you could like do this emergency in the field. So it's usually used for like military medics. But there are some videos that I saw on that. I think it was Olivier's who talked the last one. And they were just astounding. They were so realistic. And it really does like mimic what it would be like in the field if you were a military doctor. And they're those kind. The thing that I saw on my broadcast section this morning was free. You just download it for free and then you can put it on your university computers. And honestly, the level of like undergraduate biology can be things that you've moved on since I've been a neuroscientific guy. But those are the kinds of things I was doing in my, you know, just to learn about action potential in terms, right? You can do that without
describe how the scientific community, and particularly at the university, can
social structures and cultures and so forth were really spatially segmented from the scientists who use animals. And, but I actually think, you know, when you and I have talked about this, I actually think that those of us who don't use animals in our research and who study power and social structures and so forth, we've failed to actually take responsibility for our university and step up. And so that's, you know, as a political scientist, I think, you know, political scientists don't talk about animals. And so I'm actually challenging my discipline. It seems to me that the non-animal using disciplines have to challenge themselves to think about the institution that they're part of and about their own scholarly attitude about humans versus animals. So I think my discipline's guilty too. And I also think that in diverse disciplines around the university, we have incredible scholarly resources available to us to mount a scholarly critique, a complex scholarly critique of the university. So the university makes us, and we're going to break the university. You know, so the university hasn't recognized the implications of all of us residing at the university. So I have skills as a political theorist that enable me to draw up the kind of critique that I presented today. Historians, legal scholars, economists, people in First Nations, we have a real breadth and depth of skills to bring to bear on our university, and I think we have a responsibility to do that. So it's through scholarship itself that I think that we have to step up to the plate, as well as through, you know, like students organizing politically. Students have such a powerful voice if they tap into it, you know, and I know it's hard for students to be organized because they're so stressed by their studies, but they are sort of an untapped political resource at the university too. So, you know, that's how I'm thinking about the issue of politicizing this issue of the university. And then in terms of the broader culture of animal subjection, you know, it's true, and I think about this, it's true that more animals suffer more in the food industry than they do at universities. I think the university.
Oh, I was just gonna add a question that I'm not sure about this. This slide is so much at like why, given that context, why do you think the scientific use of animals is particularly important?
Yeah, so this is what I'm thinking about. I think that the university is a very special thing for society. The university has a responsibility and capacity that's completely distinct in our society. And we're not examining ourselves yet on this issue of animals, let alone, you know, I mean, there's some scholars at the university who might be the animal lover, or if you think about animals in the food industry. But most of us don't think about that at all at the university.
this kind of every single time, like, well, we don't need to do public engagement, like, and we have nothing on the possible. Like, we're here to be representative. And I'm representative of an organization that I contacted to say, I'm your representative, what do you want from me? And I never heard from them. So I'm essentially representing what? Right? So I think that, interdisciplinary conversation is really
important. I guess one thing I will add is, through my own observations, I feel like it actually isn't, like, I do agree with you that at the university level, the issue with animal use is very politicized, but it's simply untrue that in general it's politicized. Like, people, there are lots of people, students and like non-students and just everyday citizens who care about these issues. Mm-hmm. And I guess one thing that I would personally like to see more is a lot more reciprocity between people who are doing scholarly work versus activists, for example, like people who are trying to build a movement and build a community that care about these issues. So if you look at a lot of different movements, if you look at like the environmental justice movements, there is that that constant feedback mechanism between the university and the greater society, where students and external actors and like authors, scholars, or like organizers, they communicate with each other. They organize things in and outside of the university. Mm-hmm. But I think in terms of any issues about animals, that is just like, whether it's at a diplomatic level or at like a welfare level, is severely lacking.
I think that animals are an extremely emotional issue for many people, and then the activist community, and also the, I think like that framing between farm animals and lab animals is really interesting to me. So like the animal welfare program we work with is animals, right? So we have a farm, which is open house. Anyone can come anytime, you can just walk in, no big deal. And then we work with like lab animal welfare, where absolutely not. You're not gonna be able to ever come in. And so there's these different worlds, I think. But I can speak from my experience where when I was in Ottawa, there's a lot of fear in the research community about animal activism. Whether that's legitimate fear or not, I think sometimes, for example, Stop UBC Animal Research came up in conversation in Ottawa, and the entire organization was framed as threatening. And so I pushed back a little bit and I said, look, this is an organization that been peaceful and asked legitimate questions. Because someone had mentioned, like, well, we're seeing this recycling of what happened in the 80s with throwing bags and throwing bags across these things. And I was like, okay, so we need to separate animal rights activism from animal rights terrorism. And we see this as an animal activist who are asking legitimate questions that make you uncomfortable. And they make you uncomfortable for a reason. They make you uncomfortable because there's a lot of shame in the research community about practices. And, speaking from someone who's been, I've been a member of animal care staff in labs, both in the UK and here. And there's often this justification, right? It's like, oh, this is the benefits are worth the costs. Is that what we're supposed to do? The benefits are worth it. But I would always go home feeling awful because the way that I am in the world with animals is not utilitarian. It doesn't rest on cost benefit. It rests on that reciprocal relationship with the living being. And so, there are many people who, like the animal care staff, who go into their line of work because they care deeply about animals and they want to give them as good a life as possible in this environment. And it's a really big power struggle. They're like silenced in many ways. Many individuals feel like they just can't even speak about the work that they do when they're in a party's out socially. And there's like this uneasiness about the job that they do, it's a dirty job.
felt those things about the animals when I was working in the slaughterhouse, but I was so numb to it because of the repetitive nature of the work and because of that kind of reinforcement of the mindset that, at least in the research field, the benefits outweigh the costs, and here I was, you know, probably just doing my job and making my money so I paid for my university tuition. But now I see the deeper level is that what impact is creating in me as far as the feeling is, and it's making me aware of how I feel about what I'm doing. And on the surface level, a lot of people in that position will react, I think, will react by saying, you know, like, back off because we don't, you know, like, that's too much. And we need time to express ourselves in that thing, but I think that's a superficial reaction to what you might be feeling on a deeper level about how you feel about what you're doing to the animals, and afraid to express that because you're opening yourself. I mean, it's similar to a criminal admitting guilt of a murder or torture or harm, or of someone who does assault or something like that on another being pressed by a jury or a court or by the public media, and they're afraid to admit that. And I felt like that, and I still do. I feel ashamed about what I did. And I feel a lot of pain from that. But without opening up to that, then the things just become polarized. But I think that, like what you said is valid, but when I've done animal activism, especially here in Canada, they've always said, or at least the groups that I've worked with have said, we're just here to express our viewpoint and reach out to the public, and we don't want to cause trouble for the places that we're in front of and that sort of thing, which is all really nice, but it's still, I don't think there's, you know, forgetting about the people that work in those places, the labs and the factories that also have to go through a change that's even more greater than the public is not as well as they're directly in the process. And it is a very emotional issue, yes.
Basically, medicine or animals is not the fact that they don't use animals any longer in their post-secondary and maybe even in their high schools. We're looking forward to the new president because his country of origin being India, we're hoping that he'll be a little bit kinder than what his predecessor was with respect to the animals that he was seeing.
Predecessor is a human rights lawyer, though.
I'm sorry?
His predecessor is a human rights lawyer. You know, you can work with him on really.
He just shattered it for me. Race for food or a racehorse on a track. They're all